Whether you like it or not, habits shape everything about our lives. Good or bad, they fill our days, weeks, months, and years. And if you added up all the time in your life in which you are performing a habit, according to multiple studies, it would account for up to 90% of your life. Yes, you spend the majority of your life performing a habit. Out of all the habits you have, how many would you say are good ones? How much time are you mindlessly committing yourself to things that don't add value to your life? If you're like me, there have been habits you desperately want to have, but building new habits has always been challenging. I've tried starting habits like exercise programs, a better sleep schedule, and reading daily, just to fail within a few days and giving up. In my pursuit of building better habits, I came across this book, Atomic Habits by James Clear, and it has helped me become much more consistent in my approach. So I want to break it down and share my key takeaways and insights with the hopes that you can start taking on the habits that you've always promised yourself you'd develop. Our minds have a system for maximizing mental efficiency. They begin learning and automating tasks we do regularly to free up mental energy for other things, resulting in what we know as habits. Our habits determine the majority of actions we take, and these actions compounded over time determine nearly everything about our life. When we repeat 1% errors day after day by replicating poor decisions, duplicating tiny mistakes, and rationalizing little excuses, our small choices compound into toxic results. This can be a difficult concept to appreciate in daily life. We often dismiss small changes because they don't seem to matter very much in the moment. If you save a little money now, you're still not a millionaire. If you go to the gym 3 days in a row, you're still out of shape. If you study Mandarin for an hour tonight, you still haven't learned the language. We make a few changes, but the results never seem to come quickly, and so we slide back into our previous routines. James shows a graph which I feel helps emphasize the importance of this. If instead you were to focus on just a 1% improvement each day, over the course of a year, you would end up with results 37 times better than before. So in essence, small and seemingly insignificant changes in our habits will compound and produce drastic changes in our life long term. Habits are a double-edged sword. Bad habits can cut you down just as easily as good habits can build you up, which is why understanding the details is crucial. You need to know how habits work and how to design them to your liking so you can avoid the dangerous half of the blade. So now that we understand the importance of habits, let's discuss the science behind them. All behavior is driven by the desire to solve a problem. Sometimes the problem is that you notice something good and you want to obtain it. Sometimes the problem is that you are experiencing pain and you want to relieve it. For instance, feeling stressed is a problem that we all have experienced. You may have noticed yourself having built a habit that helps remove stress. It could be something positive, like going for a walk, or even something negative, like hitting a vape for a buzz from nicotine. Our brain, it simply just wants to solve a problem and does so with as little energy and effort as possible. The process of building habits can be divided into four simple steps: cue, craving, response, reward. Breaking it down into these fundamental parts can help us understand what a habit is, how it works, and how to improve it. The cue triggers your brain to initiate a behavior. Cravings are the motivational force behind every habit. Response is the actual habit you perform. And finally, reward is what's delivered from the response. These four steps form a neurological feedback loop. The cue triggers a craving, which motivates a response, which provides a reward, which satisfies the craving, and ultimately becomes associated with the cue. And this sequence is what happens every time we perform a habit. As an example, cue, you wake up. Craving, you want to feel alert. Response, you drink a cup of coffee. Reward, you satisfy your craving to feel alert. Drinking coffee becomes associated with waking up. Hopefully you can now see how our habits are shaped by our desire to solve a problem. Now that we understand this, let's break down how your habits shape your identity. James Clear talks about what he calls the three layers of behavior change. The first layer is changing your outcomes. This level is concerned with changing your results. Losing weight, publishing a book, winning a championship, most of the goals you set are associated with this level of change. The second layer is changing your process. This level is concerned with changing your habits and systems, implementing a new routine at the gym, decluttering your desk for a better workflow, developing a meditation practice to become calmer. Most of the habits you build are associated with this level. The third and deepest layer is changing your identity. This level is concerned with changing your beliefs, your worldview, your self-image, your judgments about yourself and others. Most of the beliefs, assumptions, and biases you hold are associated with this level. Many people begin the process of changing their habits by focusing on what they want to achieve. This leads us to outcome-based habits. The alternative is to build identity-based habits. With this approach, we start by focusing on who we wish to become. Because if you can become the type of person that would achieve your goal, your likelihood of actually attaining that goal is improved significantly. So the optimal way to creating a new habit is to focus on the third level of change, changing your identity. So you might ask, how can we change our identity to build better habits? Well, we first have to start by changing the beliefs we have about ourselves. Whatever your identity is right now, you only believe it because you have proof of it. If you smoked every day for years, you have evidence that you are a smoker. So the more evidence you have for a belief, the more strongly you will believe it. And evidence is created by the actions that we take. So to change our identities requires new evidence. James shares a simple two-step process to assist with this. Step one, decide the type of person you want to be. And step two, prove it to yourself with small wins. So for step one, you can ask yourself, what do you stand for? What are your principles and values? Who do you wish to become? These are big questions, and many people aren't sure where to begin, but they know what kind of results they want, to get six-pack abs or to feel less anxious or to double their salary. That's fine. Start there and work backward from the results you want to the type of person who could get those results. Ask yourself, who is the type of person that could get the outcome I want? For example, who is the type of person who could write a book? Well, it's probably someone who is consistent and reliable. Now your focus shifts from writing a book, which is outcome-based, to being the type of person who is consistent and reliable, identity-based. Now that you have a better idea of the person you want to become, transition that into taking actions in small steps to reinforce your desired identity. Remember that every action you take is like a vote for the type of person you wish to become. Building better habits isn't about littering your day with life hacks. It's not about flossing one tooth each night or taking a cold shower each morning, or even wearing the same outfit each day. It's not about achieving external measures of success like earning more money, losing weight, or reducing stress. Habits can help you achieve all of these things, but fundamentally, they are not about having something. They are about becoming someone. Now that we know all this, let's look at James's four laws of behavior change. These four laws provide a simple framework and set of rules to help you create good habits and break bad ones. I plan to make a separate video discussing how to break bad habits in more depth, but as a surface level answer, you do the inverse of these four laws. Behavior change begins with awareness. So the first step in making it obvious is to start by making a note of all your current habits. Rank them as good, bad, or neutral. The purpose of this is to simply notice what's actually going on. You can either do this as a mental note or on paper. If you're not sure on a specific habit, you can ask yourself, does this behavior help me become the type of person I wish to be? Does this habit cast a vote for or against my desired identity? The next step to making it obvious is to create what James calls an implementation intention, which is a strategy you can use to pair a habit you want to build with a specific time and location. This is broken down in a simple formula. I will behavior at time in location. For example, say I want to create a habit of meditation. It would go, I will meditate at 8 a.m. in my bedroom. So try creating an implementation intention for the next habit you want to build. Habit stacking is another method for building new habits, which James breaks down in this section. After I, current habit, I will, new habit. Again, using meditation as an example, after I pour my cup of coffee each morning, I will meditate for 10 minutes. Another big aspect of making it obvious is to design your environment based on habits you want to build. If you want to eat more fruit, set up a fruit bowl on the middle of your counter rather than hiding them in the back of your fridge to go bad. Use these as you see fit, but do your best to make the action you desire as obvious as possible. The objective of making it attractive is simple. How can we entice ourselves to do the habit that we want to build? You can use the habit stacking formula mentioned earlier and combine it with a temptation bundling formula. After I, current habit, I will, habit I need. After I, habit I need, I will, habit I want. The habit you need is the habit you're trying to build, and the habit you want is whatever you find enjoyable. Here's an example. If you want to watch a YouTube video, but you also want to exercise more, you can do something like this. After I get home from work, I will do a 30-minute workout, the need. After I do a 30-minute workout, I will watch a YouTube video, your want. Don't make the mistake I did and overcomplicate this. Just come up with a reasonable reward for yourself and do it only after you've completed the habit you're trying to build. The more attractive an opportunity is, the more likely it is to become habit forming. All right, next law. Make it easy. It's in our nature as humans to follow the law of least effort. We naturally gravitate towards activities that require the least amount of effort, such as scrolling social media instead of doing complex work. The objective of this step is to minimize the friction of taking action on your new habit. Too often, we try to start habits in high friction environments. We try to follow a strict diet while we are out to dinner with friends. We try to write a book in a chaotic household. We try to concentrate while using a smartphone filled with distractions. It doesn't have to be this way. We can remove the points of friction that hold us back. He then touches on the 2-minute rule, which states, when you start a new habit, it should take less than 2 minutes to do. So a habit like read before bed each night becomes read one page, or study for class becomes open my notes, and run for 3 miles becomes tie my running shoes. So try to break down your overarching goal into the simplest first step and take action. I mentioned earlier to design your environment to make cues more obvious, but you can also create an environment where doing the right thing is as easy as possible. So for instance, you can set the book you want to read this evening on your pillow, or you can pick out your workout clothes and set them on your bathroom counter. Small changes like this to your environment can greatly reduce the friction you have from starting. The first three laws we talked about increase the odds that a behavior will be performed. This final law is to increase the odds that that behavior is repeated. The cardinal rule of behavior change says this: what is immediately rewarded is repeated. What is immediately punished is avoided. It's much more likely for us to repeat a certain action if the experience is satisfying. Be cautious though, because if your reward for exercising is to eat a bowl of ice cream, then you're casting votes for conflicting identities. Another reward method is simply tracking your progress towards a specific habit. It's extremely satisfying to see visual progress when building a new habit, and it makes you even more compelled to not break the chain showing your progress. Eventually, as intrinsic rewards like a better mood, more energy, and reduced stress kick in, you'll become less concerned with chasing the secondary reward. The identity itself becomes the reinforcer. Quick rule of thumb: never miss twice in a row. Don't beat yourself up if you make a mistake, because we all do. Just learn from it, adjust your environment, mindset, or approach, and continue moving forward. Huge thank you to James Clear, the author of this book, as this video literally would not have been possible without it. That's it. Get out there and build the habits you've been wanting to for what seems like forever. Good luck, and I wish you guys all the best.